Hello and welcome to Macros with Maitli, the 18-hour show that takes a hard look at all the major macroeconomic issues and developments in India and overseas. In this edition, we're going to take a hard look at a major milestone that's coming up next week, the second anniversary of the Modi government. Has the BJP government delivered on its promises on the economic front? It's made a lot of noises, to be sure, but how much of this has been backed by action? And more importantly, how much it was actually translated into results on the ground? Or is it even too early to pose that question? To answer these questions, I've zeroed in on two experts who I'm sure I can rely on to give me a dispassionate and fair assessment of the government's economic performance. Let me welcome to the show Rajiv Kumar, Senior Fellow, Center for Policy Research, New Delhi, and Mohandas Pai, Chairman, Manipal Global Education, and former member of the Board of Directors, Infosys Limited. Welcome to the show. I'd like to put this discussion in perspective by asking both of you in turn. Is 2 years really too short a time to assess the performance of the government? After all, change, especially in democracies, happens very slowly. What one government sows, another reaps, whether good or for bad. We saw that happen during the first term of the UPA government, when the sharp pickup in growth was largely, though not entirely, on account of the groundwork laid down the previous NDA regime. So if 5 years is too short a period to see results within the term of the concerned government, can we really assess the government's performance after just 2 years, or are we being unrealistic? Rajiv?
Maitri, I think we are being both in some sense unfair and also not particularly useful in doing this evaluation after 2 years, simply because the current Prime Minister and previous Prime Ministers, you know, have asked for 60 months or 5 years to deliver the promises that they have made during their campaign. And therefore, I think it would have been worth, it would be useful to give that time period to the government. Nonetheless, two other things I would like to say. One, which is that in these 2 years, there have been a huge amount of work that has been done across a very large number of sectors and themes and regions, etc. And I think sometimes people might say that this has been actually too large rather than very large. But my own impression is that the Prime Minister is trying to lay down the markers and galvanize a bureaucracy which has been in some sense caught up with sort of inertia and lethargy. So that's the first point that I want to make, that a large number of schemes have been launched, which in some scenes cover the beachfront for getting the government off the ground. And second point is that if by the end of these 5 years, or even the end of 4 years, because that is material, 50% of the targets or 50% of the schemes were actually met, you would have seen a very large amount of progress done in the tenure of this present government.
Okay, now let me ask Mohandas question, the same question Mohandas. You know, Rajiv says 2 years is too short a time period and the government has laid the framework. They've done a great deal of the basic groundwork that is necessary to really spin off major economic growth in the country. But given the fact that in today's world, and the media hype that goes with it, you know, the government is bound to be assessed when the second anniversary comes up. So how would you assess the government's economic performance in these 2 years?
Well, I would break it up into two halves, much like what Rajiv would have done. And one to say, have they taken policy changes? Have they debugged the system? Have they helped industry and economic growth? And that is a resounding yes. We must remember that when they came to power, the fiscal situation was very bad and they were in terrible shape. And also, we had very high inflation. Then we had all these projects which are in the pipeline, which are not approved. Then we had high corruption. And now what this government has done is to debug the entire process, remove this pileup, and remove corruption, which is a very, very big thing. We have not heard of any corruption in Delhi for the last 2 years, which is fantastic. And then brought in a series of policy measures like insurance, Make in India, you know, roads, power sector, and in defense, etc., which are fantastic, including the startup policy. So they've taken all the right decisions. Now, have these decisions impacted things on the ground? Obviously, the impact has not been very significant, almost not there. And the reasons are not very far to see. Investment has fallen off because, you know, banks are in deep trouble, the NPAs are coming up, the external environment is very hostile, growth has come down, commodity prices have collapsed. And thirdly, there's been drought for 2 years. So 50% of India does not have purchasing power, and a lot of money has to go in mitigating drought, and the mood is also somber. So I think if you look at these two things, on one, resounding yes, 9 out of 10. On seeing the impact on the ground, in the railways little bit, in the roads little bit, power certainly, coal certainly, and in terms of ease of business, certainly there's a move. So I would say that we need one or two more years to see the impact of all this, but they had a great start. And like Rajiv said, the bureaucracy seems to be working, led by a very active prime minister. Globally too, respect of India has gone up tremendously. I've been abroad 3-4 times, spoken to many people. There's a sea change compared to what UPA was. Everybody looking up to India. They understand India is still difficult. It is, you know, it's going through everything that, you know, is not so easy. But they're very positive at the pace of change and the opening up. And we're seeing global leaders come. So on the external front, I think, is a fantastic transformation.
Okay. So Rajiv Mohandas is even more generous than you. He says it's been a great start and well begun is half done. But it's only half done. And yet when this government, it is true that when this government came to power, all the talk was really about the twin deficits, the fiscal deficit, the current account deficit. Growth was low, inflation was high. And 2 years down the line, the twin deficits have largely disappeared. Growth has picked up and inflation has definitely fallen. So has the government really affected an economic turn around? And how should we assess the government's economic performance? It's common to measure it in terms of GDP, but is that the right measuring rod, especially in a country like India? And we also have the added complication, of course, posed by the revision of GDPs. So the comparison with the past is not really strictly valid. So should we not be looking at a more disaggregated picture in terms of, say, jobs or more regional balanced development, sectoral development? And if you look at that, how is the government done? We haven't seen jobs being created. Rajiv?
Yeah, Maitri, I think you've raised a very important question. But let me start off by saying that I am not one who believes that you bring down the twin deficits and therefore you won a big victory. Because you can always bring down the two deficits, which is the current account and the fiscal deficit, by just simply lowering growth. And as it happened in our case, the trade deficit and the current account deficit has come down simply because our imports are weaker, but the exports are even weaker. But that would just mean that because of the slowdown in our domestic demand and in the import of capital goods has gone down, and then we have had a huge mana from heaven, which is in the decline of the petroleum prices. Now these are all very fortuitous things, and at the same time also not a sort of trend that you want to encourage, which is that you want to improve your twin deficits by bringing growth down to a halt, because in our country that just means disaster. And that means disaster simply because of what you just said at the last, which is that it does not generate employment. And if it does not generate employment, our much touted demographic dividend can convert itself into a demographic nightmare. So what I therefore want to say at this point of time, that at the end of 2 years, the Prime Minister and all his cabinet colleagues and the senior bureaucracy should jettison, and including the RBI, should jettison all other policy objectives and have only one, which is the generation of employment, as the criteria and as the litmus test for the success of their policies going forward. If that doesn't happen, if employment is not given the prime and perhaps the exclusive position of the policy goal in this country, then I'm afraid many names might have been made and many brownie points might have been earned, but the people of this country will rise up in revolt, and that will not be a pretty sight.
Absolutely. Mohandas, I could see you nodding to everything that Rajiv was saying. But the excuse that we often hear from the government for the slow pace of reforms is that the government does not have the requisite numbers in the Rajya Sabha. And that is both factually correct and unlikely to change. So if we were to segregate reforms into those that were stymied by the opposition and those that the government could have done on its own, how does it stack up on the latter? Has it done enough that it could on its own, especially as far as jobs are concerned? FDI and retail, for instance, is one case where jobs could have been created if only the government had done that. And that is an executive decision. Mohandas?
Well, I think on the job front, I totally agree with Rajiv, and we'll extend it further to say, we are facing a demographic nightmare, not a dividend. There is no dividend. There will be no dividend. Let's be very clear about that. Right now, there are 100 million young people in the age group of 21 to 32 without jobs. We produced 25 million babies 20 years ago. They're all attained the age of majority. Out of them, maybe 1 million will die before the age of 5. 24 will attain majority. Maybe 10 million, 12 million may have some jobs, you know, formal or informal. The rest have no jobs. And the next 10 years, if we don't grow, we're going to end up with 200 million people who don't have jobs because the economy is not producing jobs. And I don't see the sense of urgency at the central level and the state level for job production. I totally agree with Rajiv. The number one priority of this government should be job production. And for that, what they should do, they should focus on labor-intensive industries. For example, the garment industry. There are small changes that they want. They can easily do it without going through the law. They can focus on them. They can make sure that the needs are required, needs can be done. Import-export procedures for garments can be eased, and all that mess and corruption at the ports can come down. And then they can look at all the small companies and see what they need to help to make them get into jobs. They can reduce the cost of PF and ESI because there's a very heavy cost. I mean, Manish Sabharwal has been saying for somebody who wants 10,000 rupees, PF, ESI contribution is 45%. Bring it down to 20%. And PF and ESI is making huge surpluses, charging people unnecessarily high. At least bring down the cost and do other things to bring down the cost. So there I agree. The focus has to shift to jobs. First 2 years, they focus on getting their act together, making all those easy reforms. But now it has to do on jobs. And lastly, the states have to come together. There's a huge disconnect between the states and the center. The center is not talking to the states. There's antagonism, and the states are the ones who create the job. But Modi will be impacted if there's no jobs in the next 3 years, because people will tell him that we voted for you 5 years ago, 2 years ago, and you know, we're not seeing the growth. And you can't point a finger at the states and say, you know, the states didn't do the job, I did everything else. So I think now you must get the states on board, because in democracy, people vote. People vote, and people are important. It's not the power plant, it's the people. And we don't want him out of power after 3 years, because I think it's a great boon for this country. And also, he must make sure that he's seen as creating jobs.
Absolutely. So jobs, jobs, and jobs. That should be the focus of the government. But I'm afraid on that note, it's time for us to slip into a very short break. Please do stay with us. We'll be back very soon. Welcome back. You're watching Macros with Maithili, and we're discussing the government's economic performance on the eve of the second anniversary of the Modi government. Rajiv, before the break, we were talking about jobs, how the government hasn't focused enough on that. In fact, there's a growing sense that the government has focused more on acronyms, clever one-lines, Stand Up India, Make in India, Minimum Government, Maximum Governance, Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, Red Carpet, Not Red Tape. It's been focused on atmospherics, if you will, and not enough of delivery. The classic example from a sector that I'm familiar with, the financial sector, is a bankruptcy code. But the passage of the bill merely means that we take one more box on the World Bank's doing business matrix. But nothing really changes on the ground, because nothing has been done to create the necessary infrastructure, as in filling up the vacancies in courts, providing the physical infrastructure in DRTs. One has only to look at the budgetary allocation to the law ministry to know that the government has no intention really of walking the talk. So what use are all these smart one-liners?
Maithili, as I said earlier, these one-liners actually are reflective of the programs and the projects that they represent. And I think I don't have any sort of anything to argue against it, because that does represent, as I said, a lot of work in progress. And I dare say that a number of steps have been taken to improve the infrastructure and to improve the ease of doing business, which will, in the long term, in the medium term, you know, create jobs and help the generation of jobs. But the fact is that this is, as I want to say, that this is not sufficient. What is sufficient is to now focus on the jobs and therefore take the macro policies which will help promote them. For example, you should have a competitive currency going forward, and you should assure your exporters that they will never face the dilemma of having a overvalued currency. You should have a huge program of public housing, because no other country in the world has had successful industrialization without reducing real wages by giving to the workers housing at a cheaper rate and public education at a cheaper rate and good quality public education. So my argument, Maithili, is yes, we have done a lot. Yes, we have started off a large number of schemes, but now is the time to consolidate, and consolidate only in one respect, which is to ask yourself the question, have I done enough, for example, in education that will give me enough jobs? Have I done enough in my currency management or in my interest rate management that will generate enough jobs? And if not, I should be doing that. And I think this is where the one other thing that which referring to what Mohandas had said, this one-liner about creating Team India is actually very important. The center and the states, absolutely, the prime minister and the chief ministers will have to act as one team to take India forward in a fiercely competitive global market. And for that, I want to suggest that the resurrection of the inter-state council is far more important, because clearly Niti Aayog is a technocratic body which will not be able to handle this political issue of creating a Team India whereby everybody can pull together in the same direction and create the jobs that are necessary.
Won't that, Rajiv, mention the same point that you talked about earlier, how the center and the states must work together? And the government has repeatedly said that the union government has done whatever it could within its remit, and now the action must shift to the states. The PM, in fact, is on record on how cooperative federalism is the way forward. And the government's acceptance of the 14th Finance Commission recommendations devolving more tax revenues to the states is in keeping with this thinking. But the fact is that if you look at the BJP-led states, they don't seem to have performed much better than the non-BJP-led states. So what is really holding them back? Are the states really echoing the BJP's line? In the case of agriculture, for instance, we've seen the maximum change in the Karnataka government, which is not a BJP-led government, and we haven't seen much traction in the BJP-led states. So what is all this talk about cooperative federalism?
Well, Maithili, you know, if the national priorities have to be translated to state priorities, there has to be closer interaction. The programs have to work together, funding has to be there, common reviews have to happen, many things have to happen, and they have not happened. To give you one example, West Bengal is suffering from the overhang of debt. They did not restructure the debt because the left had some ideological differences. Now the Mamata government has been asking to restructure the debt. Why can't they restructure the debt? West Bengal is a part of India. Why do you want to make them suffer because of huge debt, which all of the states got restructured? West Bengal didn't do it because this cussed left was there and they had ideological problems. That is one. And the south of this country has a power deficit because lack of transmission. Why is Piyush Goyal, who is talking so much on TV about power, not focusing on improving power transmission to the south? I mean, the south seemed to be a stepchild for the government in Delhi. The south is being ill-treated in many, many areas. And why are not the road minister and the railway minister coming down south, talking to the southern states to improve the infrastructure much more in the south? Because remember, the south has been the engine of growth for India for the last 10 years, and you're ignoring them because you don't seem to have a political interest in here. And why are they not talking to the government like Rajasthan and Maharashtra closely, you know, quarter upon quarter to improve? I think a lot more has to be done. And I think that will only come if the focus shifts to actual work on the ground. And that can happen only to the state. And I think the government in Delhi is realizing that their policies will only work if it comes to state. But I like the slogans, because we all need the slogans just to make sure work goes on. And the slogans, I think, concentrate the mind. So we should not rubbish that. And I think Startup India, you know, Swachh Bharat, they're all nice slogans, and they concentrate the mind, they concentrate the projects, and they are useful. But I think the big issue is jobs, state-center relationship, action on the ground.
Okay. Rajiv, so Mohandas is once again more charitable as far as these slogans are concerned. I myself am quite a skeptic. I think we need more action. It's time we put our nose to the grindstone and did some work instead. But look, having considered all that, Rajiv, what would you consider as the government's single biggest success? Would it be the overhaul of the tax protocol with Mauritius, the JAM treaty, Trinity, or the changes that have been made in the petroleum sector? What would you consider is the biggest success of this government?
I think the biggest success of the government is undoubtedly removing corruption from high places and providing to the investor the assurance that he would not have to deal behind the closed doors or under the table to get his or her work done. I think that's a very big step forward. Along with that, I think the second big step forward for this government is to bring the infrastructure back on steam. The highways, the ports, the electricity, the Uday Yojana. I think all of those. That's the second big achievement that I can recount. And the third and the final one is that they have tried their very best to get the blocked infrastructure projects off the ground. They've monitored the 68 projects, you know, very large ones involving, you know, capital investment about more than 1,000 crores, and they've tried to unclog them. Now they've not been, but at the same time, I must mention two where the government has not done very well. And one is the tax regime. They've not simplified the tax regime. They've let this hang like a Damocles sword over the countries, despite the promises that they have made. And I think, and the statistic that came out that there are only 10,000 and odd people with incomes of more than a crore is actually just hilarious, and the tax administration should have been doing much better. That's one. And two, they have not changed the policy formulation exercise from being a iterative one where one agency is blaming the other to one which is a collegial one where everybody sits down, all the ministries, all the agencies, the RBI, the government, all everybody should be brought together in one place and said, this is what we need to do and agree upon that agenda. Because we have had too much of this, sorry to say, nonsense about one ministry putting the blame on the other and then another government putting the blame on the other. And as a result, there is just a log jam and nothing moves forward. I think it's time to change, and I was hoping that Mr. Modi would do that as he had done actually in Gujarat.
Mohandas, Rajiv gave a long list of both the successes as well as the failures where the government has not done enough. But actually amongst the successes that he mentioned a number of things like corruption that are not strictly in the economic domain. So if I were to ask you to focus on the economic domain, what do you think has been the government's biggest success and what are its biggest failures? And I don't want you to mention things like GST law because that was not within its remit. What are the things that were purely within its own remit? Maybe, as I said, once again, returning to the point of FDI and retail trade. Now, that was something that the government could have done. It could have resulted in a great number of jobs. So what do you think are the biggest successes and where do you think it has fallen short? Mohandas?
Well, I think the big success which Rajiv has not spoken about is the entire world is positive about India and foreigners want to invest in India and they're waiting. And I think they're coming in. FDI has gone up. I think that's very good. And making peace with our neighbors all through. So economically, we are becoming part of global treaties. We are becoming part of the global order. We're looking at funds to come in. And that's very, very encouraging. The masala bonds, you know, the funding for green energy, the green energy fund. These are all very big issues. And we're looking at, investment in defense in India with foreign collaboration, opening up the market to them. I think all that will bear fruit in the next 2 or 3 years. That is a very, very big one. And the second big one, I agree with Rajiv on infrastructure that was there. But the deficit, as far as I go, tax terrorism is still big. 8,35,000 crores of disputes. Now, in the UPA regime, there was, perverse assessments for everybody. And they were there for companies who don't do certain things. And I can give you names, but I don't want to give you names. And, there are huge demands being made on companies. They have to be resolved. The pace of resolution is very less. Adia has brought in good reforms. You have a good revenue secretary who's got his hands on. In the next 6 months, we want those things to be done. For example, this Vodafone, why can't they set up a panel and reform it? And retrospective amendment, why can't they just say it'll be prospective and remove all this and go to the courts and do something else? And the failure of justice. Our justice system has collapsed. There is no justice in this country. And economic growth cannot happen unless there's justice. We need a functioning legal system. This is a failure. That is, the whole legal system and the tax thing is a failure. The second failure, I would say, education. You have to invest in human capital. In the last 2 years in higher education, we've gone backwards. There has been more control. Delhi is controlling everything. More control, more norms. Push it down. And whatever freedom you had much earlier, I think is deeply constrained. And we don't see any improvement in the future because, the Delhi has been captured by a set of people who don't know what to do. And the education policy which they talk about is not going to make an impact because whatever they announce now will take 3 years. In the first year, they should have brought in educational reforms because human capital is the most important asset a country can have. And human capital takes a long time to build up. And our human capital is going down. And the future looks bleak because the children are not getting educated. College education is collapsing. The quality is not good. Larger numbers are coming. They're going on the streets. So I think these are the two negatives, I would say.
So starting from a very upbeat tone, Mohandas, I've now made you give vent to your angst. But Rajiv, now that the plumbing is largely in place, we did speak about the government doing a number of things and the nuts and bolts. Where should the government focus its energy in its next 3 years in order to cash in on the groundwork that it has done?
Well, I think it has to supplement the huge amount of groundwork and incremental steps that is taken by some bold structural reforms in some critical sectors that will help to generate employment. My first top of the list is agriculture. It's broke in this country. Education that Mohandas referred to, it's completely broke in this country. Exports, 17 months of continuous decline, cannot be sustained, and we don't know what to do. So therefore, you have to bring some new initiatives there. Fourth, I think after exports must be our manufacturing sector. despite what Mohandas has said, you know, the fact is that the credit offtake from the banks is at the lowest in the last 30 years. And no manufacturing capacity is being created. About 60% of the new FDI has gone only in what you would call equity ventures, you know, on startups, which does not generate employment. And finally, I think something that you said, retail trade, and you know, and which will connect our agriculture sector to the markets, and all of that which goes to improve the value addition and the elimination of intermediaries from the farm gate to the table, from the farm gate to the consumer, because that's what we need at this moment to get our employment generation a new impetus. And I think finally, yes, one more, and which is tourism. And you know, it's pathetic what we are doing with our tourism. We get 7.5 million tourists. Bangkok, Thailand gets 25. The city of New York gets 50 million. None of these sectors that I've mentioned have been on the radar of the government. They should be. Incrementalism here will not work, and therefore you need bold structural reforms in these sectors to supplement a lot of good work that you've done to get the employment generation.
Absolutely. So we come to the crux of the issue. We need more jobs, but I'm afraid we've completely run out of time, so we'll have to end this discussion. The verdict regarding the Modi government's performance in the first 2 years is perhaps best described as well begun. But that's it. What is indisputable, however, that it still has a long, long way to go. Thank you so much, Rajiv, as well as Mohandas, for joining me and sharing your views. Thank you also for watching. Remember, next week we'll be back with yet another edition of Macros with Maithili. Till then, it's thank you and goodbye from all of us at ET Now.